At its core, a computer, like its name might suggest, is a computational device. And as a species, since humans figured out we could gather food and wealth for later consumption, we have been plagued with computational problems. At first, our problems were simple, like counting the members of our immediate family. Then our problems became counting the dimension of stones we needed to cut. And then it became counting the number of animals we had on our farms. When we discovered flight, our problems became even more complex. Now, we had to compute stocks and trends in the global market. In recent times, we are trying to compute the distance between our Earth and other planets around the universe. As you can see, in each generation, the complexity of our computational problems has grown. As it turns out, our premium device for computation, the computer, has also been evolving with our problems. At the core of the computer evolution is its processor, or its processing power. Remember that? From the first sand table computers to modern day computers, we have gone through generations of computers. In each generation, we figured out a better way to process our input in order to produce the needed output. Here are the most notable generations in the history of computers and the characteristics that computers in those generations shared. First generation computers. These computers were made between 1940 and 1956. The primary processing medium for these computers is the vacuum tube. First generation computers used vacuum tubes for circuitry and stored information using magnetic drums. The input mechanism was punch cards, and the output was some sort of printout, like on a piece of paper. Computers in this generation shared the following traits. Their programs were written in machine code or binary numbers. Don't worry about what that is for now. As such, they were very hard to program. They were large and produced enormous amount of heat. As a result, they needed large space and humongous air conditioners to run. They were awfully expensive to operate, and they consumed a large amount of electricity. As such, they lacked any commercial appeal. No company wanted to buy them. They were also very unreliable and prone to hardware failures. As a result, they required constant maintenance. Because they were hard to program, they lacked the versatility and capabilities of today's computers. So an example of a first generation computer is the ENIAC, or the Electronic Numerical Integrator and Calculator. Wow, even the name is hard to say. Yeah, that whole room is the computer. The circular contraptions in the ceiling are air conditioners meant to keep the computer cool. Second generation computers. These are computers made between 1956 and 1963. The primary processing medium for this generation of computers is the transistor. Transistors were better than vacuum tubes because they consume less power. In addition to the processing medium improvement, computers in this generation were also programmed with assembly language, a programming language that was closer to spoken language than machine language was. It used mnemonics or abbreviations for instructions rather than numbers like the binary number did. Computers in this generation also shared the following traits. Compared to first generation computers, they were smaller and faster. They were more reliable and less prone to hardware failures. As such, they required less maintenance than the first generation computers. Because they were smaller, they occupied less space and generated less heat. Thus, they did not require the same amount of air conditioning to run. And because they were programmed using assembly instead of machine language, programming them was less cumbersome and more time efficient. An example of a second generation computer is the IBM 1401. As you can see, it is significantly smaller than the ENIAC. Third generation. These are computers made between 1964 and the early 1970s. Their main medium of processing is the integrated circuits. Integrated circuits were significantly better than both vacuum tubes and transistors because they ushered in an era of smaller, faster, and more reliable computers. This generation of computers even allowed some modern-day components like keyboards for input and computer monitors for output. In fact, it was in this generation of computers that we saw operating systems that paved the way for computers to run many different programs as they do today. The most memorable trait of these computers was that they were smaller and cheaper than their predecessors. As such, they had not only commercial appeal, but also consumer appeals. Many everyday people could buy them. Finally, programming third-generation computers was even easier than programming second-generation computers because more and more higher-level programming languages were introduced. A higher-level programming language is farther away from machine language and closer to spoken language. As such, they are easier to learn and use. Fourth generation. These are our modern-day computers. These are computers made from the late 1970s to present day. Their primary processing medium is the microprocessor. Microprocessors are cool. They are an evolution of the integrated circuits. In fact, if you look closely, you will see that a microprocessor is simply a bunch of integrated circuits mounted on a single chip. They allow computers to be even smaller, giving way to tablets, touchscreens, smartphones, and other forms of electronic computers. This generation of computers are more powerful, more compact, more reliable, and even more affordable. As such, they give rise to enormous innovation in the software engineering industry. Computer programmers like myself can now write graphic-intensive programs, and digital stores like Google's Play Store have been created to deliver those programs to you and me. When Apple launched the iPhone in 2007, it demonstrated the power of microprocessors and the possibility of mobility for this generation of computers. Since the 1970s, we have been evolving this generation of computers by increasing the number of transistors we place on a single silicon chip or microprocessor. Example of this generation of computers is probably what you are using right now to take this course. Our modern-day computers have opened our minds to the wonderful possibilities that lie ahead of us. They enable us to innovate in different areas of our lives. I am certain that soon, quantum computers will be the next generation of computers. They will allow us to write programs that can take advantage of quantum theory. Don't worry about what that means. Even the smartest people in the world haven't figured out what it means yet. But the point is, they will be really, really powerful.